Hello everyone, welcome back to my channel. This is Alan in Warrington, and I've come to see the final resting place of a very famous man. I'm going to give you a little clue. I think this is right. This is the clue. Turned out nice again? No? hang on. With me little ukulele. Okay, it's George Formby. I know it's not a big cemetery, this one. You just keep going left. I've seen it on the map, Google Maps, so we'll find it. It's massive. Anyway, it's got a really big stone, so it's got a nice fountain in the centre and things. So let's do the little bio. You know, George Formby was born on the 26th of May 1904. In the beginning, he was a stable boy and a jockey. But after many years of doing that, he decided that wasn't for him, and he changed. And then in 1923, two big changes happened to George. Made a big difference to his life and his career. Firstly, he bought the ukulele, and secondly, he bought the wife. No, he married Beryl Ingham. She was who he was married to. So that was quite a big year for George. And I think he never looked back after that. Basically, Beryl became his manager. So she was a controlling force, and she was, when I say controlling, I've got some stories I can tell you. She was very, in the industry, a lot of people disliked her. She was very, very, very strong woman. I think she negotiated a deal where he didn't write the songs, but normally the songwriters make all the money. And she got his name on as co-writer, I believe, but definitely co-profits, and that was extremely unusual.
But his biggest break came in 1934 when he starred in his first film.
From Betty Driver, who was talking about George Formby, because she worked with him, and also about George's wife, who was a little bit tough. Let's just put it that way. Beryl became his manager and transformed his act. She insisted that he appeared on stage formally dressed and introduced the ukulele into the performance. He increasingly worked in film to develop into a major star by the late 1930s and early 40s, and became the UK's most popular entertainer during those decades. The media historian Brian McFarren writes that on film, Formby portrayed a gormless Lancashire innocent who would win through against some form of villainy, gaining the affection of the attractive middle-class girl in the process. Formby's screen persona influenced Norman Wisdom in the late 1950s and Charlie Drake in the following decade, although both these performers used pathos, which Formby avoided. George Harrison was a fan of Formby and a member of the society and advocate of the ukulele. The rest of the Beatles were fans. They improvised with ukuleles during the recording of breaks in Let It Be. The Beatles' penultimate song, Free as a Bird, ends with a slight chord, including a strumming ukulele by Harrison and the voice of John Lennon played backward, saying, "Turned out nice again." In 2004, Formby was introduced to the Ukulele Hall of Fame, a non-profit organisation for the preservation of the ukulele history. His citation reads, "In part, he won such love and respect for his charismatic stage presence, technical skill, and playful lyrics that he remains popular 40 years after his death." In June 2012, a Blackpool boat car tram number 604 was repainted and returned to service, with sponsorship from the George Formby Society. The tram was named George Formby OBE, and images of him are affixed within the trolley. And then George, he started his recording career in 1926, but he moved into films from 1934. He was a very big star, he really was. He worked for the Entertainment National Service Association, and by the end of 1946, they reckon he'd appeared in front of 3 million people. That's pretty good, isn't it? You know, I myself was never a big fan of George Formby, but yeah, you know, he did a lot of good. He took a little bit of a dive, and then he continued to tour the Commonwealth, doing variety and pantomime. So his last TV appearance was in 1960, 2 weeks before Birrell died. And surprised a lot of people, because 7 weeks after she died, he announced his engagement to a lady who was called Pat Howson. He didn't actually get to marry her because he died shortly after that. The biographer of him said that, in a way, he sort of encapsulated the working class of Lancashire. And he also influenced a lot of comedians like Charlie Drake, Norman Wisdom, and even the Beatles mentioned him in some of their songs. I was watching a clip of Russell Brand's programme one day, and it showed a film of a George Formby convention, and the people were loving it, strumming their little ukuleles, singing along. And he said, basically, horses for courses, if you know what I mean, quite apt for him being a jockey at one point. But some people love, like, George Formby, and some people don't. But you can't take it away from him. He was a big, big star. He's had 5 biographies written about him, 2 TV spectaculars, and 2 public sculptures. And we're here. So, and he's got a big, big grave as well, look. So here we are. Shame about the one next door, isn't it? Looks like it's been bombed. Hello, George Formby. In loving remembrance of George Formby, comedian, this is the father, senior in other words, he died on the 8th of February 1921, aged 45 years. After life's fitful fever, he sleeps well. Okay, and then we've got also George Formby, OBE, who died on the 6th of March 1961, aged 56 years old. A tradition nobly upheld. Also, Elizabeth Ann, devoted wife of George Sr., who died on the 31st of July 1981, I think it is, aged 102. Wow, she went a long time, didn't she? The songs are ended, but the melodies linger on. Mother and Louise. Quite a big thing, isn't it? Quite a big grave. Yeah. Let's just have a look around the back. Make sure we're not missing anything again. It's got a nice feel, this place, because it's not too big. The Manchester one cemetery, Southern Cemetery, is so big. Yeah, no, nothing on the back, really. Yeah, I remember seeing a little picture of Frank Skinner with his ukulele stood here. Obviously, Frank's a big fan. I'm a big fan of Frank's as well, I loved his autobiography. If you see this, Frank, give me a thumbs up on it. Yeah, I've just seen this as well, we better see what that says. Right. There we go, it says Georgina D. Hallis, granddaughter, died the 11th of October 1954, aged 3 years. Happy wanderer. Dear. A bit sad, isn't it? Well done, George Formby and Senior. Well done, George. You entertained a lot of people. Thank you, George. Well done, mate. Very good. So, he was, whatever you say about him, a really influential entertainer. I wouldn't have been thinking of him myself as one of my favourites, but you can't take that away from him. He entertained a lot of troops during the war. And did a lot of good. And, I mean, I remember stories. There were things like, he used to say, he'd write a song, and he'd be sat in the back of his car and say, "That's another house I've bought." You know, and Birrell was a very hard woman, very business strong woman. She drove him forward, which you've heard in the clip from Betty Driver. But he's one of our culturally biggest entertainers. So, George, well done. So thank you for watching. I hope you're all having a good day wherever you are. Tell me what you're up to. Give me a thumbs up and a comment. I love the comments. And subscribe and ding the bell, because that's lovely. You'll see more videos as soon as the